Welcome to Nambour Anglican Parish's online service. My name is Ralph Bowles. I'm the minister in charge of this parish in southeast Queensland, Australia. We've put together this service for the many members of our parish who at this stage are not able to return to physical worship services due to the pandemic risk. We have started to transition ourselves back to gathered worship with some restrictions. But we know that this might change at any time, so we intend to continue to broadcast this kind of service, giving you an experience of what it is that we do when we gather together. We hope that the message, the praise, the prayers, the experience of this service will encourage you in your Christian walk during this somewhat difficult and uncertain time. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Let me pray for us. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Praise and thanksgiving to God. Make a joyful noise to God, all the earth. Sing the glory of his name. Give to God glorious praise. Say, how awesome are your deeds. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honour and glory and praise. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, and as you sing psalms, hymns and spiritual songs with gratitude in your hearts to God. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Gracious God, we humbly thank you for life and health and safety, for freedom to work, leisure to rest, and for all that is beautiful in creation and human life. But above all, we praise you for our Saviour, Jesus Christ, for his death and resurrection, for the gift of your Spirit, and for the hope of sharing in your glory. Fill our hearts with all joy and peace in believing, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amazing grace, how cool this grace.
peace. We are the body of Christ.
His spirit is with us.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Members of our parish are invited to give their support by online giving. You see the link on our website. Prayer over our gifts. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have these gifts to share. Accept and use our offerings for your glory and for the service of your kingdom.
Blessed be God forever.
And now we come to the ministry of the word. Thank you, Father, for making yourself known to us and showing the way of salvation through faith in your Son. We ask you now to teach and encourage us through your word, so that we may be ready to serve you for the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Today's reading is from Genesis chapter 32, verses 22 to 31. That night Jacob got up and took his two wives, his two female servants, and his 11 sons and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. After he had sent them across the stream, he sent over all his possessions. So Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When the man saw that he could not overpower him, he touched the socket of Jacob's hip so that his hip was wrenched as he wrestled with the man. Then the man said, "Let me go, for it is daybreak." But Jacob replied, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." The man asked him, "What is your name?" "Jacob," he answered. Then the man said, "Your name will no longer be Jacob, but Israel, because you have struggled with God and with humans and have overcome." Jacob said, "Please tell me your name." But he replied, "Why do you ask my name?" Then he blessed him there. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, "It is because I saw God face to face, and yet my life was spared." The sun rose above him, and he passed Peniel, and he was limping because of his hip. Hear the word of the Lord. Praise be to God.
The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew, chapter 14, beginning at verse 13. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. When Jesus heard what had happened, he withdrew by boat privately to a solitary place. Hearing of this, the crowds followed him on foot from the towns. When Jesus landed and saw a large crowd, he had compassion on them and healed their sick. As evening approached, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a remote place and it's already getting late. Send the crowds away so they can go to the villages and buy themselves some food." Jesus replied, "They do not need to go away. You give them something to eat." "We have here only 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, they answered. "Bring them here to me," he said. And he directed the people to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish and looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and broke the loaves. Then he gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the people. They all ate and were satisfied. And the disciples picked up 12 basketfuls of broken pieces that were left over. The number of those who ate was about 5,000 men, besides women and children. This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Let us affirm our faith together.
We believe in one God, who made and loves all that is. We believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was born, lived, died, and rose again, and is coming to call all to account. We believe in the Holy Spirit, who calls, equips, and sends out God's people, and brings all things to their true end. This is our faith, the faith of the Church, believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
What does it mean to have a relationship with God? Fundamental question, correct? I know that religion for many people is about rituals, it's about practices, about living a virtuous life or reaching out to a God who may be quite removed from everyday life. Certainly not a God who returns our calls and actually interferes in our life and responds to us. But the Bible does talk about our relationship with God as a real relationship between believers and God. So what does it mean? Now, one way of describing the Christian life we've been looking at here in these sermons is the idea of union with Christ, the concept of union with Christ. What does it mean to be united with Christ, the Son of God? It's a rich, deep, and powerful way of understanding the Christian life. And I've been suggesting to you that a good summary of the New Testament teaching, mainly Paul's teaching on this subject, is this statement. You are in Christ, and Christ is in you. We are in Christ, and Christ is in us. What does it mean to have union with God, union with Christ? We are in Christ, and Christ is in us. And that breaks up into four particular aspects. Two in each of the halves of that statement. We are in Christ by, I've been suggesting to you, participation. We are in Christ because we are participants in his victory. We looked at that the other week. And we are in Christ by identification with him. We are in Christ as people who belong to him, and we share a status through our relationship with him. We are his children, his offspring, citizens of his kingdom, followers of Christ as Lord. And then in the second half of the statement, Christ is in us by our incorporation into the body of Christ, our belonging to his people in whom he dwells. And today I want to look at the final of these four aspects of union with Christ. We are in Christ. Christ is in us by our communion with him. Christ is in us in a spiritual union of mutual indwelling. And as we look at these four aspects, I want you to just notice that they move from the more outside us, the more objective, if you like, to the very personal and inside us aspects. So first of all, we think about what Christ did for us and how we benefit from it. Then we think about the status we receive from that as identifying with him. And then we can celebrate the fact that he is in our midst and indwells us as members of his body. And finally, we come to the center of it all, the deepest and closest center. That is, we live in a marriage-like union with Christ. You see, these four aspects of union with Christ all have metaphors in the New Testament. We participate in Christ by being dying and rising with him. When he died for sins, we died with him, and the old sinful self died with him. When he rose victor over death, we rose with him, and we will rise with him. We identify with Christ by being clothed, if you like, with Christ, clothed with his character and his status. We incorporate into Christ as part of his body, as belonging to this temple. We are like the stones, the living stones of the temple. And now in communion, we think of our union with Christ as being marriage-like, of mutual and loving indwelling. So this is holy ground indeed today as we think about communion with Christ as part of our union with him. And I just want to describe it under several terms, three words to describe it. First of all, it's personal, a personal union. Secondly, it's a mutual union. And thirdly, it's an indwelling union where the two parties live in each other's lives. Let's look at these three. Our union with Christ is a personal union. It's a relational bond between the believer and the Lord, a real bond. It's not a mystical or impersonal union, a personal oneness. Sometimes people have a kind of mystical religion. I'm one with God, the God that is in everything. And it can sound very profound and very wonderful and deep, but essentially it's impersonal. It's kind of general mystical oneness with God. Now, our oneness with Christ, our union with Christ, is much more than that. It is personal. We put our faith in Christ. We pray to him. We talk to him. We listen to him. We pray, we follow him. We obey him. St. Paul sums it up very well in a famous statement in Galatians. I have been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Galatians chapter 2:20. The life I now live, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. Someone said, faith is our way of living in Christ and with Christ, and of demonstrating the power of his living in us. We put our faith and trust, our allegiance in Christ. It's very focused on our relationship and connection to him. So our faith in Christ is a relationship allegiance. It's a connection to Christ, a whole person response. It's not that we just have some certain beliefs about Christ, like we say a creed, we do, but it's much more than believing certain things about Christ. It's much more than a set of ideas or beliefs. It's faith in Christ. The preposition matters. And that faith brings obedience. It brings love for Christ. If you obey me, you will love. If you obey my commands, Jesus said, you will love me. John 15, verse 9. So our relationship with Christ is personal because it's a personal allegiance of love and commitment between us and the Lord. And this relationship we have does not overpower us or crush us. We still remain persons. Christ does not take us over or supplant our personality. As Lewis Mead says, my life in Christ is my own life. The life of Christ within me is also my own life. It's a personal relationship, and therefore we as persons have an integrity and a part of it. Christ and us together, two persons, if you like, relating together, God and us. There is a kind of religion where the personality of the worshipper is sort of taken over. It's a bit like a zombie. You're no longer yourself. You're taken over by the power of the God, intoxicated, if you like, by the power of God. But St. Paul never talks about the life of faith as a kind of mystic absorption of our personalities into Christ. He never talks, as someone has said, he never talks of losing himself as a drop in an ocean of infinity. In some religious traditions, merging with the God, being united with God, is like a drop of water, blending into the ocean, losing its identity in the abstract and great ocean of the divine. This is not Christianity. It's not what the Christian life is like. Our union with Christ is two becoming one. I'll come back to that at the end. The two not taken over, one not taken over by the other, one in loving relationship while still being two. A good relationship between two parties, two persons, respects the integrity of the two and helps each party become more and more the person they should be and fulfill their proper role, not one person taking over the life of the other. In marriage counselling, one of the problems when a marriage goes into difficulties is one party de-selfs, becomes less themselves. The other person controls and dominates their life. This is not the Christian life. So it's a personal union. And secondly, it's a mutual union. This is sort of implicit, but let me draw it out for you. Our personal union with Christ will mean that both Christ as our Lord and we as his servants contribute to the relationship. It's a two-way thing. It's a two-way thing. It's a mutual covenant, like a marriage. When we have a baptism service, we remember this. A baptism service where both the Lord and the disciples are disciple who's being baptized exchange promises. The Lord promises in the gospel grace and his presence and his love, and the disciple promises allegiance and faith and obedience and love. I will remain Christ's faithful soldier and servant to my life's end, as our Anglican baptism says. In this sense, baptism service is like a wedding service. The Christian life is like a wedding, an exchange of vows and prayers. The Lord promises much to us, and we promise a lot in return. It's a mutual relationship. We can see this mutual relationship and union of promises in the New Testament, all over the New Testament, particularly perhaps in John chapter 15, 1 to 11. Let me read it to you. I am the true vine. My Father is the gardener, said Jesus. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he prunes so that it may be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me and I will remain in you. No branch can bear fruit of it by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. As the Father has loved me, Jesus says, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. It's mutual. The vine supplying the branches with life and the branches depending upon the vine. I was given a small book when I started out as a Christian by a friend. I remember it. I haven't got it now. A little cheap little book called the Jesus Person Pocket Promise Book. And it listed all the many promises that God makes to us. And indeed, that's what a mutual relationship is like. Commitment to one another, making promises and keeping them. The Lord is full of promises to us, and we make our promises to him to keep the relationship going from our end as far as it lies with us. But we should look for and work for the growth of our relationship in Christ and with him, to learn more of him, to draw closer to him, and to abide in Christ more fully. There's a wonderful passage in Paul's letter to the Philippians about this, which is one of my favorites. He says to the Philippians in chapter 3 about his Christian life, I want to know Christ, yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow attaining to the resurrection of the dead. Not that I have already obtained all this or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it. But one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining toward what is ahead, I press on toward the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenward in Christ Jesus. This is the upward call, or the heavenly call in Christ Jesus, to press on to know the Lord better in a mutual relationship. The third aspect I want to mention flows through it. So these sort of build on one another, these three aspects. This will be a union with Christ is an indwelling relationship. Now, an indwelling union, indwelling is the best word I can think. I tried to find another word, but I think this is the best word. An indwelling union is when the lives of both parties or both persons intertwine while being two. So they share life together. The joys of one becoming the joys of another, the struggles of one becoming the struggles of another. They, while staying two, they become one in a deep interconnected sense of indwelling the lives of each other. You can see this in kind of indwelling in the reality of true love in marriage, I'd say, in family life. In good marriages where the husband and wife so indwell each other that they share each other's burdens, even feeling each other's struggles and so on. Certainly the healthy love of parents for their children are like this. And I've known a time when worried and burdened about one of my children was so great, I felt it like a pain inside myself. And when a person's in your heart and they're in your life and you're in their life, you indwell them and they indwell you. That's what love is all about. Love is that power, it's been said, that enables us to live in the lives of other people in the best and good sense of the word. Now, the Father and the Son have indeed a special kind of indwelling union as the divine Lord, divine God. And a similar kind of indwelling, Jesus alluded to, will be in the relationship between the Lord and the believers. This is what he prayed for. And in John chapter 17, in that great prayer, the Lord prayed in this way, that there would be a relationship with his disciples in him that would be rather like this, close and intimate indwelling of the Father and the Son. Verse 20 of John 17. My prayer is not for them alone, he prayed. I pray also for those who will believe in me through the message, that all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought into complete unity. And then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. In other words, we are to remain in Christ and he will remain in us. We will indwell each other's lives. And Jesus says, the Father who indwells the Son will in a kind of derived way become a real person. God will live in us in this way. And that will be a great witness to other people. We will remain connected to Christ and he will remain in us. So when we have this indwelling union with Christ, we come to a connection, a relationship with the Father, which Christ enjoys. So friends, there are the three aspects of what it means to be united with Christ in a communion. Communion with Christ that is personal, between person to person, that is mutual, where the Lord and ourselves both contribute to the relationship, and close. That's another word for it. So close that there's a kind of dwelling in the lives of each other. Through our union in Christ, we grow closer to the heart of our Lord, and his life in us becomes stronger. His burdens become our burdens. His love permeates and illuminates our lives. The motto that I'm fond of for the parish of Nambour, having to come up with a motto, I suggested sharing the love of Christ. We share the love of Christ as he lives in us. And if we share the love of Christ, if his love and love for him so indwells us, then that love will start to be seen by others. May it be so as we draw closer to Christ in the union we have with him. So be it. Amen.
Let us approach the throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. Let us now confess our sins to Almighty God.
Heavenly Father, you have loved us with an everlasting love, but we have broken your holy laws and have left undone what we ought to have done. We are sorry for our sins and turn away from them. For the sake of your Son who died for us, forgive us, cleanse us and change us. By your Holy Spirit, enable us to live for you, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
From the letter to the Romans, chapter 6, verses 10 to 11. Christ died to sin once for all, but the life he lives to God. In the same way, count yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Jesus Christ. God desires that none should perish, but that all should turn to Christ and live. In response to his call, we acknowledge our sins. God pardons those who humbly repent and truly believe the gospel. Therefore, we have peace with God through Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us join together in saying the Lord's Prayer.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, your Son Jesus Christ has promised that you will hear us when we ask in faith. Receive the prayers we offer. We pray for our world leaders as they make the difficult decisions about everything, whether it's people starving due to natural disasters or fighting, people dying from coronavirus, people fearful. We pray that Christian leaders will always seek your guidance for their decisions. And we pray particularly for our Australian leaders, for our Prime Minister, our Premiers, as they have to make difficult decisions. And we pray that people and leaders will consider the needs of others and not just of themselves. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Father, we just thank you so much for our blessings. Please make us aware of just how blessed we are, particularly when we start to have grumbles, Lord. Help us realize that everything that we have comes from you. And we thank you too, Father, for our church leaders, for Archbishop Philip, for all bishops and all priests and deacons. We pray, Lord, that you will bless them all as they do your will. And we thank you so much, Father, for giving us Reverend Ralph. Bless him and bless his ministry here in our parish. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we pray for all people in our communities, that we will be good examples of people who show your love, your peace, and your forgiveness, and particularly with our families and our friends and all who we meet. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we bring before you now, Lord, those who we know who are suffering. We know so many people who are depressed, anxious, angry, sick, whether it be physical or mental or spiritual. They may have lost their job. They may be in prison. We pray, Lord, for each person that we know who's struggling in any way. We pray for healing, for comfort, for peace, and increased faith. And we pray too, Lord, for the people who care for these people who are in such need. Give them patience and guidance in how to treat those people they care for. We pray for our health workers, our police, our military, who are caring for us and supporting us and risking their lives. We pray for those people who have lost their loved ones. Lord, be with each one of them. Let them know that you are there for them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we thank you too, Father, for your servants who are now with you, and particularly for those ones that have helped us in our Christian walk. We pray, Lord, that we will continue to do your will while we are here on earth until we meet you in our eternal life. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And we thank you, Father, for hearing our prayers, and grant that what we have asked in faith, we may by your grace receive. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Loving God, we thank you for hearing our prayers, feeding us with your word, and encouraging us in our meeting together.
Take us and use us to love and serve you and all people in the power of your Spirit and in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Friends, we know that many of you are not able to join us in our gathered fellowship for celebrating the Lord's Supper. But we invite you now, in a few minutes' time, to perhaps get some bread and something to drink to represent the bread and the cup of the Lord. And we will share in a kind of virtual communion together and remembering what it is to share in the body of Christ. To participate with, by faith, in the presence of God in our midst, in commemoration of Christ's death. So you might like to go now and get some something to eat and some wine or some juice, and we will celebrate this in a few minutes' time. The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Loving God, in union with Christians throughout the world, we offer you praise and thanksgiving today. Even though we are unable to eat and drink the Lord's Supper together, we rejoice in our union with Christ and his body through the Spirit and rest in his saving gift of life. Amen. Listen to what St. Paul said about the Lord's Supper. He said, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this, whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" Let us pray. We thank you, Heavenly Father, that though many of us are unable to share together in the Lord's Supper at church, and yet we know that we are one with you in Christ by his Spirit and have our fellowship in the Spirit with millions of Christians around the world. Help us then, Lord, to experience the eating and drinking by faith as we have fellowship with you. In Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us eat and drink together. Amen. May the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you what is pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace, filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. In the name of Christ. Amen.